Okay, once again, good afternoon, students. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic that is based on signal conditioning, particularly the process of amplification, right? In our last class, we have discussed about the instrumentation amplifiers, right? So some important point that we have left in that class. So today we will cover that part. So first of all, how the process of amplification is done and why it is required. We will start from the basic concept. Okay, so as far as the process of signal amplification is concerned, especially in case of biomedical measurements, right, like ECG, EEG and CT scan, etc. So in case of these measurements, the measured signal is usually at very low level. Sometimes it is at microvolt level. It may be voltage or current, and these signals are commonly known as biopotentials, right? So in order to read this signal properly and process these signals for the proper treatment, because this is a very critical measurement, so we need to take care of this part. So these small level signals, which are at microvolt level, these are amplification is required, right, in order to boost the level of these signals so that we can match the requirement of recording and display at the output side, so that proper precautions and treatment can be further processed. Okay, so this is this slide basically gives you the requirement of amplification. Okay, as far as biomedical field is concerned, normal amplifiers are not used because of certain reasons. I'll discuss this point in our next slide. So up to this point, you can understand that the biopotential signals, which are at very low level, these are processed with the help of a special type of amplifiers, and these amplifiers are known as biopotential amplifiers. So you all know that in order to measure the biopotentials, usually the electrodes are placed on human skin. If you have some experience in the hospital, then if somebody is going for the ECG, then some kind of electrodes are placed on human body, and then a signal is recorded in the ECG machine. So, right? So these signals from the electrodes pass on the amplifier stage first, and then further processing takes place. In this image, you can see that some electrodes are placed on the human body, and then the output signal is sent to the biopotential amplifier, right? So in biomedical applications, I have already mentioned the normal amplifiers does not work because of a lot of reasons. Because in case of biomedical applications, the amplifier should have high gain, high common mode rejection ratio, and should contain low power optimization. Okay, and the most important point is, the biomedical amplifier must be free from noise, and any kind of distortion must not be there, because it is a very critical field. So proper amplification and proper diagnosis of the signal must be there. So this slide shows you some important examples of biopotential amplifiers, out of which the instrumentation amplifier we have already discussed, and we have said that the instrumentation amplifiers mainly used in ECGs and EEGs, right? And there are some other examples like carrier amplifiers, chopper amplifiers, isolation amplifiers, etc., right? So today we'll be discussing the carrier amplifiers. Okay, as its name suggests, carrier amplifiers, so it makes use of carrier signal. And once the carrier signals came into the picture, one very important process of the signal conditioning is the modulation, because whenever modulation takes place, we make use of carrier signals. So ek important cheez yahan se nikal karke aati hai ki carrier amplifiers ke andar agar hum carrier signal kaam le rahe hain, to wahan par modulation bhi picture mein aayega, theek hai na? Isko hum aage discuss karenge. And further, these amplifiers are used in case of the passive transducers, which require the external source of excitation. Today we will take the example of strain gauge for this particular case. So, if you think about the process of the carrier amplifiers, or rather the principle of working, then first the DC input signal, which is the biopotential, is first filtered by low pass filter and then used to modulate with the help of carrier wave so that it can be amplified properly. This is our main concept behind the carrier amplifiers. This is very important block diagram of carrier amplifier. First, let us understand, then we will discuss the different components of this carrier amplifier. Here you can see this is a carrier oscillator. One by one we'll discuss. Right now I am giving you some glimpse of this block diagram. This is your strain gauge with bridge circuit, okay? And earlier, in case of strain gauge, we have discussed that the bridge circuit may contain one strain gauge, two, or all the four branches may contain strain gauge, right? So it depends upon the problem under consideration. Here we are assuming that out of four branch, any one branch having strain gauge transducer, okay? And this is your carrier oscillator. This is the amplifier, rectifier, phase sensitive detector. It is nothing but your demodulator, because whenever modulation takes place at the transmission side, then at receiver side, the signal must be demodulated. And the last component is direct writing recorder. It is nothing but the output device for recording purpose, so that the proper control and precaution has to be taken care of. Okay. So one by one, we'll discuss all these components in our subsequent slides. So as far as component is concerned, we can list out these component. So there are six components as far as the general block diagram of carrier amplifier is concerned. Number one is carrier oscillator, then strain gauge transducer, then amplifier. Here, amplifier is special type of amplifier, which is multi-stage capacitance coupled multiplier. Please take a note of that, right? Then rectifier, and then the demodulator, that is phase sensitive detector, and the last is direct writing recorder, that is output device. As far as the carrier oscillator is concerned, the major function of the carrier oscillator is to energize the transducer, right? It means it provides supply to the transducer, and we are using strain gauge in this case with an alternating carrier voltage, right? Alternating carrier voltage is nothing but your carrier signal. In block diagram, you can see that this is a carrier oscillator, right? And this is the carrier signal generated by this oscillator. Its main function is to give supply to the strain gauge, okay? Our next component is strain gauge transducer. When we studied about the strain gauge transducer, we have seen a lot of application, particularly for automotive industries, right? But apart from this sector, the strain gauges finds a lot of application in medical industries, right? Because the strain may be the result of force, pressure, moments, heat, structural material, and changes. Okay. So nowadays, the important hospital equipments like syringe pumps and kidney dialysis machine, these are rely on wireless strain gauges to discover the optimum fluid flow rates. Okay. And nowadays, recently, the CT scan machines and mammography machines are also implementing wireless strain gauges for their proper diagnosis of the signal. We know that there is an ability of the strain sensor to measure the resistance change of material body depend upon the force, right? Whenever force is applied, then some changes occurs in the body, and that strain created is measured in terms of electrical resistance, right? And these kind of pressures are usually predominant in the medical field. So in order to look into the problem here, we want to say that whenever we want to measure the change in resistance, right, in terms of strain, then Wheatstone bridge finds lot of application, right? And looking to the problem under consideration, one, two, or all the four branches of the Wheatstone bridge may consist the strain gauges. Okay, so here I have shown one picture so that you people can understand easily. First, the principle of strain gauge is to convert the applied force, pressure or torque into the change in electrical resistance. Here you can see that the first block is showing a symbol of strain gauge, right? And the second is the bridge circuit. Here I have shown one blank branch. Here in this particular branch, a strain gauge is connected. So this type of bridge is basically your quarter bridge, where only one branch having the strain gauge, and further supply and gain is there, right? So the information signal from the body, right? We have said that the electrodes are attached on the skin of the human body. So the information signal from the body electrodes reaches the transducer, and where it is amplitude modulated with the help of carrier signal, which is obtained from the oscillator. Okay, so the amplitude of carrier signal is changes according to the physiological variable being measured. What physiological variable is to be measured? It's it is used for the changing the amplitude of carrier signal. This is the basic concept behind the amplitude modulation, right? So the output of transducer would be an amplitude modulated signal, that is AM signal. Here in the block diagram, you can see that picture. This is your carrier oscillator, and the signal is, suppose in this branch we are using the strain gauge, and the force is applied to this branch. Then the change in electrical resistance with the help of this carrier signal, and this signal is basically your amplitude modulated signal, and this amplitude modulated signal is fed to the amplifier. Now come to the amplifier part. We have already said that we are using a multi-stage capacitance coupled amplifier. It basically consists of three stages. Okay, so in the first stage, the amplification of amplitude modulated signal, that is AM signal, is done. In the second stage, it responds only the carrier frequency signal, that is high frequency signal, and most of the noise is eliminated here. This is the main important part of this carrier amplifier, and further amplification is done in the third stage. Okay, now the rectifier, you all know that the output from the amplifier is converted into the unidirectional signal. Rectifier converts the amplitude modulated AC signal into the DC signal, right, with the help of rectifier. Now come to the phase sensitive detector or demodulator. With the help of phase sensitive detector, it is basically the demodulator, right? The signal is demodulated. It helps to extract the amplified signal voltage after the filter circuit. Actually, filter circuit is not shown there. You can also draw the filter circuit up to that point, right? It is one of the effective way to recover the small signal which is buried by large ambient noise. The phase sensitive demodulation, it is also known as PSD. It is an important signal conditioning equipment. It has two inputs. In the block diagram, you can see that the PSD, that is phase sensitive detector, has two inputs. One signal, that is after rectification, the DC signal is coming to the demodulator, and this is our reference signal. So the main function of this phase sensitive detector is to sense not only the amplitude but also the phase, right? It compares both of the signal and then generate the required signal. So it compares the phases of the reference, that is carrier signal, and incoming DC signal, and thus able to recover a weak signal from an overwhelming background noise. Now the final stage is direct writing recorder output device. Finally, the voltage, that is output voltage from PSD, is then applied to the driver stage of the writing system for recording purpose that can be used for further analysis. So this is all about the today's class.